Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So, you all just heard about train and railways and all that. And are you all awake right now? And since yesterday, you have been hearing a lot about user experience, design, and kind of thing. And I must thank the UX India team to begin with, because they have indeed helped me to choose the title. So I'm kind of stolen the title from UX India itself. What is the theme of UX India conference? Sorry? Impact of design. So I've just added inclusive as a world. So which we are going to talk about the slightly different than from what you have been hearing since yesterday. By the way, before I get started, is there any people with hearing impairment in this room? Can someone say yes or no? No hearing impaired. Any persons with a visual impairment? No, great. Because I want to always make sure my presentations itself are as accessible as possible. So in case if anybody cannot see this slide deck all the way to the screen, you can go to the slide share and look for C. Srinivaso, and actually slide deck is there online as well, and including the full text. Okay, so, okay, let me see, oh, it's working. So what is inclusive design, by the way, right? But before that, let me, this is all the agenda we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about what the inclusive design is all about, and then the impact of design from the social perspective, technical perspective, and financial perspective, and legal perspective. So this is what we're going to cover about. The reason why I've chosen this topic is, a lot of times, people will keep telling us, oh, accessibility is equal to for blind people or people with disabilities, which is not really the case. Though, of course, it helps people with disabilities a lot, but that's not the only case. Okay, now coming to what is the inclusive design all about? How many of you don't use elevators in your offices? Can you say yes or no? How many of you don't use elevators and use only the stairs? Anybody? Not many, right? Okay. The elevators are actually basically meant for my friends like nursing who is sitting here, okay, who may not be able to climb to the steps. But all of us in this room want to use the elevators. Okay, so though the intention is to build for someone, but it's actually helping. Even the thing is that you will see people using elevator going from ground floor to first floor. Am I not right? Yeah. And so are the cases with ramps. If you look at a lot of offices, in one way they will have three or four steps, and on the other way you will have, yeah. On the other way you have ramps, okay? But most often you see it's actually used by everybody else. And also, when it comes to the ramps in shopping malls and all, what is it used for? When you have a big shopping cart, you'll actually take it through your ramp and put it into your car. So it's actually using beyond disabilities. Ideally, that's again meant for people who use the wheelchairs or pregnant women, okay, or elderly. But everybody, all of us take the benefit out of it, right? All right, now coming to subtitles. How many of you do watch subtitles on the televisions or cinemas? Most of us do. Especially if you are looking at a Telugu movie sitting in Hyderabad, and you don't know Telugu, you'll say, oh, it would have been nice if there is a subtitle, right? And it's actually meant for hard of hearing people, right? But we all of us look for the subtitles, for sure. And just now our friend talked about the Rail Yatri, right? How many of you go to railway stations, airports, and bus stands? Everybody, right? So, do you listen to the announcement and board your train, or do you just look for any visual element, visual information? Mostly not. We all look, gossip to the co-passengers and wait for the announcement to happen, right?
You can take a break after this, right?
Absolutely, yeah. That is happened. And nowadays the problem with airports is, in the interest of saying something like silent airports, it's actually dangerous for people especially with visual disabilities. A lot of times they only display, and if we don't pay the attention to the boards and we miss our flight, there can be chances, right? And not only for people with visual disabilities, there can be this kind of situation will be others as well. Inclusive design is different. It's not really rocket science. It's actually building a product which is usable to all users. Nothing but to actually make sure your build, your application or your product is usable to all users, irrespective. Like we all say about, if you look at the job portals today, we are equal opportunity employers. We provide jobs irrespective of gender, caste, disability, and elderly, or whatnot, right? So it's as simple as that. So, for instance, if you are using Facebook today, okay, you would end up using that when you actually become an elderly person, right? And if at all that Facebook is not accessible due to whatever physical limitations you come up, when you grow up towards 60, 70 years, you'll say, what the kind of design it is? And I'm sorry, but I actually have a wish for all the visual designers, actually at least most of the visual designers who love to use the dark background and gray text. You know what is that wish? At least for a day, they should become the people with low vision or elderly person. For a day. If not forever, at least for a day, they should become with a less vision and start looking at their applications, own applications. So when you actually build any product which is actually accessible, like I said, it's not a rocket science. They mostly make building an accessible product, you don't need to oftentimes, at least 70 to 80%, trust me, you don't need to do any special things. It's all about keeping the semantics in mind and using our brain in a right way, okay? For a very simple, since you are all designers and it's a design conference like our internal event, I'm open to talk about designers themselves because you will relate to your own examples, right? And it's not to hurt you or offend you or anything. Oh, thank you. Okay, it's not to offend you anything. But what if I have made these slides, I have anyway used the black background, and if I use the dark blue font color, what will you people tell me? Not readable, right? And this is the same complaint we all will be having. So, and when it comes to developers, you all have to use the semantic and write techniques.
Check.
Today, thanks to the technology, you can, yeah, checking is over, man. Yeah. So the thanks to the evolvement of technology and the hard work happening at W3C, you come up with any technology, where it may be Bootstrap or Angular or jQuery, JavaScript, or anything you use, there are techniques to make it accessible. And if any of you have a myth that to make an accessible product, I need to compromise on my design, no. You can build as beautiful design as you want, but make sure they really look beautiful, okay? Unless if your definition of beautiness is something like a less contrast ratio, I'm sorry. But as long as it looks beautiful, you don't need to worry about how it looks like. Everything can be made accessible at engineering, right? And if I say that I'm a blind person and I use screen reading software, and your application works great, very well on my iOS device or Android device, you'll be happy, right? So it actually benefits, and you know one thing? We say that we are actually, technology is helpful and we are using technology quite a lot, right? For some people, technology is actually required, necessary. If you look at our shopping complexes today, person who is blind, person who is on wheelchair, it's hard for them to go and shop there. But thanks to our e-commerce, we can sit at our home and do the shopping as much as we want. Our friend has just talked about Rail Yatri, right? Suddenly, a blind person or a nursing Rao goes to him and say that, you know what, I can't go to a railway inquiry counter in Dilchuk Nagar and find the information, but by using your application sitting at my home, I'm able to get all the information. Will you not be proud of? Okay. So once you actually build an accessible product, you're actually creating a social impact. Okay, you're also raising awareness among the other product companies, other companies. And as we said, it inspires community. Like if you go and tell somebody, you know what, my product can be used by you as well as a blind guy. He said, wow, that's cool. So you're actually inspiring that other person to actually learn from you. The financial benefit, as Narsingra was pointing out, the sales will increase, right? Once your application is actually become accessible, you will have much more users, right? So if your application doesn't work for me, why would I actually use it, right? I will straight away uninstall it. But if it is actually working, we use it, people with disabilities use it, people who are elderly will use it, and people who are actually relying on low bandwidth connections will actually use it, and so on, right? So you're actually, the increase will, from the financial sector, and also it will reduce your cost. You can actually reduce your investment on accessibility and mobile readiness. Okay, once you actually start thinking from accessibility right from design stage and including accessibility right from your engineering and everything, you're actually reducing your cost. Otherwise, if you actually think of accessibility at the last minute after the development, you'll actually pay a lot of money to me, okay? Because I'll actually make you to rework an entire application. So you'll also avoid the lawsuits. Because in countries like US and Australia, if your application is not accessible or your building is not accessible, people can actually go and file a lawsuit against you, right? But if you're actually thinking from the practice itself, you will actually get rid of those lawsuits. And legally, you'll be more prominent, and this is the kind of benefits you'll have, right? So it's actually impacts quite a bit in your business as well. It will save you financially, socially, legally, and so on. So with that, in the interest of time, we'll actually close this presentation here. If you have any questions,
Yeah. So for accessibility, if we pass section 508 and which is the 2.0 accessibility guidelines, is that okay? Is there beyond that, is there anything we need to do for accessibility?
Okay. That would be your first step to pass the section 508 and WCAG 2.0. It's a guidance to you, okay? It's not the entire thing. It depends on how you are actually, what kind of your application you are. But if you actually, first step would be to actually pass all those requirements. Then the second step, based on your audience, okay? Is there anything needed to be done, okay? But this is the your guidance part, which will actually help you to at least 80-85%. But it will still not be complete, because there'll be, based on your region and based on your requirement and audience, there may be a few additional things you might be needing. But to satisfy the compliance and to say that you are accessibility, okay? But achieving the complying with this WCAG 2.0, at least AA level, not AAA, would actually help you quite a bit. Ranjit is not allowed, right?
Not allowed? Okay.
But yeah, you can.
So one question, basically. So every country has a lot of accessibility guidelines, sections, and WCG, various levels and stuff like that. UK has separate, German has German, US has separate. I think India is also developing something.
Why shouldn't we have these many different rules for different countries? Why not it's the universal one rule applies to every accessibility?
I'm glad I allowed you to ask the question. It's an interesting question, but did you finish your question?
Yeah.
Why not? It's actually a myth, okay? You're talking about Section 508 in the US, European accessibility standards in the Europe, Australia accessibility standards in Australia, web guidelines for government websites in India, okay? You're hearing all these different things, but all of this is actually derived from WCAG 2.0, which is by W3C, Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.0. The accessibility part of all the standards will include only WCAG 2.0, but they will also add the country specific. Like if you take the instance of web guidelines for Indian government websites, they will also talk about what is the kind of brand entity needed for Indian government websites, how the Indian government emblem should look like, how is the navigation structure look like for them, what are the colors should be used. So it's actually, some of them, they come up with the standards for the country specific, but basic accessibility requirements are taken by WCAG. So all the companies who are here, what we should be doing is that, let's not initially think about the country specific rule sets or guidelines. Comply with WCAG 2.0, and that will help you to fill in the WPAT documents, which is by Section 508 in the US, or any country specific documentation you will be able to fill with. But your basic document and your ground document should be WCAG 2.0. Okay, that is a universal, accepted and adoptable accessibility standard. And in fact, that is the one which is adopted by United Nations as well. The Rule 9 of the United Nations Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities talks about accessibility and asks users to comply with WCAG 2.0. Okay, as a designer, how many of you will agree if I propose you should make one beautiful looking website and one text-based website? How many of you will agree? Yes or no? I need an audible answer.
Very good. I appreciate all of you. Okay, and we will not recommend any two separate websites because, one, it is not usable. We are talking about all users. So there should be one product for all users. There are enough techniques available in the technologies, in the technology stack, and the standards. There are enough things available to make the
one product accessible. You use any technology you want, but you can make it accessible. Quite a little exceptions is like something like a Canvas or SVG, which are work in progress. Okay, but the reason we do highly discourage people to come up with text-based website for visually impaired people is that it actually adds the cost to the companies, because you also need to make sure that you will maintain the same content on both websites, right? And why will other people come to the text-based website? Even if people with low vision like me, or even people with blindness themselves, don't often go to the text-based websites because it will not have the full functionality. You cannot search, okay? You cannot filter, you cannot do anything. Why? They don't even use it, right? I would highly recommend, do not go for text-based versions. It is again a myth.